We return to Vampire the Masquerade, the Ivory Wall, a game set in West Berlin 1989, in which our coterie is entirely comprised of members of Clan Torres, or posers, artists, revelers, specialists, shall we say. One, a bizarre Epicurean. Another, a procurer and provider of vessels to the mighty, both of whom, sordid in their activity, are now tracking down the whereabouts of the urban legendary figure, Party Boy, a vampire in Berlin, supposedly active, who has, on a number of occasions, made great attempts to breach the masquerade, humiliate the elders, and generally be something of a nuisance. His identity, his actual name, is not known, but he has done things ranging from retelling elders' secrets in the forms of dance numbers in popular nightclubs. He has sprayed masquerade breaching graffiti on the walls. He's listed the traditions in spray paint pretty much on the side of the Berlin Wall. He is completely boundless, and recently he is accused of having not only sprayed fangs on the ghoul bodyguards of the prince, but also of having disrupted the Elysium which one of our protagonists, Karl Schweitz, was being introduced, and taking photos of the prominent Toreador Heinrich George, the mortals that were with him, pointing out, as well as taking a photo of Heinrich, that he was a prominent actor from before the Second World War. The flash of cameras went off as the group fled. Now, I'm going to turn it over to the players. I'm going to turn it over to John to describe just his character's take on the last night's situation, the events, and then I'd like Eunice to recap with what his objectives are and what his ghouls have been up to during the day, and I will be able to tell you what the results were.
Hello, good evening, and welcome. Yes, Carl, I suppose he's quite confused by the activities of the previous night. There have been a lot of things that caused him to draw parallels to his own situation in terms of being bloodbound to his sire, in terms of being seen to be a disappointment for things that, well, weren't entirely his fault, really. He was a bit of a conspiracy theorist, a bit of a bullied sort of punk in his life, and now he begins to feel as though he's almost sort of copycatted that role. Transferring his skills into this new society is proving more difficult than he thought. He finds it very difficult even to get food, as it is now. So he takes to reminding himself of his past glories by consuming actual food, which is one of the things that drew the attention of his erstwhile sire to him. Regarding the main plot theme, Carol, he's suspicious of all of this. It all seems to, like, how can no one stop this guy? These people have limitless power, and he's, from what he's gathered, a nuisance, a youngster, allegedly, who's popped up in recent times. He's not some ancient dread that everyone's afraid of. He's a kid. So how is it in his hands suddenly to find this upstart? And why have they entrusted it to him, possibly the most inept member of the court? Can it possibly be this Party Boy? Or is there something else at play here? And what of the mysterious Eastern Berlin kindred? But even as he begins to think these things, they all fade in his mind, because in his supernaturally bound state, he can only ever feel the desire to please his sire, and that is essentially what it all comes back to for him when all's said and done.
Eunice?
Oh, yeah. Well, In terms of what we now are planning to do, where we're basically going to move to from here, is we're going to investigate the locations that are connected to the people that this party boy was coming to the Elysium with to disrupt our little get-together in the Elysium. We ran over one of his buddies there and searched his pockets and found student ID to a university, which is one location we need to scout for clues. And the other was a membership card to a St. John's Rightful Word Church, which is another location to investigate, to find clues to the possible whereabouts and new leads. In this case, I sent my two ghouls, I have five, but I sent two of them, one of each, to these two locations. I gave the guy's student ID to one of them, who's going to the university grounds during the day to just get the feel of the place and kind of what's going on and what the place is like, so that we don't just walk into an unexpected trap, and that sort of thing. And the other one is gonna scout out the St. John's Rightful Word Church because most likely these places would be closed during the night. So they'll go and do a bit of reconnaissance. Also, something to mention is that a fledgling Bruja by the name of Sebastian Steinbeck was supposed to make his first appearance in West Berlin in the Elysium where this all went down. He never showed up, and the invitation that the party boy and his little goons there who came to the door and snapped the photographs of my character's sire and all that, they had Sebastian's invitation card. So either he's being apprehended by them, or he's working with them, or something the other. That's something we need to figure out. And that's pretty much it. I also have, my character happens to have plans to meet one of the other Toreadors of the city this night to discuss an upcoming party, but that's nothing to do really with exchange gossip and information and that sort of thing inside within our little clan there, so that we're all on top of the situation. And so that's basically what we're aiming at. I'm not moving towards the church or the university before I get some recon from my ghouls about these two locations.
So, and that is where we will start tonight, with Anna awakening. Both of you, of course, lose a blood point for doing so. which shouldn't really be much of a pain to Carl, who has gluttonously fed in the last evening, but to Anna, that may prove something more of a burden. During the day, as you say, now just to clarify, Anna sent two ghouls to the university and two to the church?
I can't recall if I said that. Either I sent two to each, or... No, I think I would have sent one to each just so that they wouldn't draw attention to walking in pairs and such, and also so that I have enough at hand if I would need them if something were to come up, you know.
And as we've profiled, I think three of your ghouls have now been detailed in terms of personality.
I think I've only written down things for... Bruno is the grunty bodybuilder type who's been driving me around last night, and Fritz was the ghoul who was maintaining my little club thing that I had.
Yeah, and Friedrich was the one that knocked down the mortal the previous night in the car. He was the initial driver. Bruno then came to pick you up.
Ah, yeah, that's right.
And just to provide, again, a bit more, a bit of character to the three, yes, Bruno is of a bodybuilder, Scott Steiner build, and probably the same sort of bleached hair look.
Chainmail.
Yeah, he wears the chainmail on his head. No, he has a crude scar marring his face, which is the biggest differentiator. Fritz is the slightly more effete one of your ghouls who was responsible for running at your club, your underground techno joint. And Friedrich, for all intents and purposes, resembles a high-class chauffeur. He's very neat, very trim, very stiff, often wearing greys, charcoals in colour, hands often gloved. He keeps himself to himself and doesn't really talk with the rest of the ghouls. As the others are fairly social with one another. There's certainly a pecking order, and they go up and down in it like nobody's business. But Friedrich has always stayed somewhat on the edge, and you've never seen him as alarmed as he was on the evening, yesterday evening, when he ran down that mortal.
Yeah.
Now, would you like...
It was actually one of my vessels. It was Max who ran over the mortal with the car.
Oh, no, I had it down as one of your ghouls.
Yeah.
I had it down as Friedrich. We'll consider
that. Friedrich was the one who picked him up from the Elysium. Oh, but anyway.
Yes, no, I recall now. For some reason, my notes aren't matching up with yours. How embarrassing. Okay, well, that is Friedrich, either way. And Werner is a much older man. Older in appearance than you, in fact. Anna, of course, resembles a woman in her early to mid-40s.
Yeah.
Werner is a man who's looking more in his late 60s. Quite thin, quite serious, quite severe, but he has the nose, the squash nose of a boxer, and the somewhat intimidating glare to him. When the ghouls are together, they often look to him for authority just based on age, if nothing else. He has lived through a fair amount in these last 60 years. Finally, Klaus is the youngest of the group. He is a big boy, but not in a muscular sense. He looks more like the... bodyguards hired by the prince, except less Turkish. He's just filled out. He is made to be large so that he's intimidating. But you know for a fact that he couldn't carry himself in a fight as well as Friedrich, or perhaps even, or Bruno or Friedrich. He is there for impressions mostly, but he has a very good social capability on a par with Fritz. So, with that being the case, which ones would you wish to send where? We know that Fritz was in the doldrums. He was certainly not rated as highly as the others after last night's events.
I would have sent Werner to the church, and I would have sent Friedrich to the university.
Okay, and you presumably sent Werner with the card for the church and Friedrich with the student ID?
Yeah.
Okay, although you've not asked, I will give you the actual name of the student, because presumably you did look at the ID.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like a German name. It's actually in the name of Johnny Wist.
How do you spell the last name?
W-H-I-S-T.
Okay.
An old-fashioned card player, obviously.
Rummy whist.
Okay.
So, the night commences, and it would appear that Friedrich has already returned. He is awaiting you outside of your room, and he's basically stood to attention. His hands are behind his back. He's not sat down. He is not the kind of ghoul that ever gets comfortable until his mistress commands that he is allowed to. His mutter commands that he is allowed to.
Okay, if I have spent the day basically without any problems, I'll just once I've gotten up and done all of my morning routines, as it were, I would have then opened the door to my bedroom and met him with a smile and just expecting him to lay it on me.
He gives you a stiff, curt nod. You're half expecting his heels to click together as he does so. Mutter.
Good evening, Friedrich. What do you have for me?
Good evening to you, Mutter. I have been to the Free University as you directed, and he passes the student ID back to you.
I'll take it.
I did some digging around. It was not too difficult to track down who this whist was. Appears to be an American student at the Free University.
All right.
Was studying some science course or other. Edwards, he gets his little notebook out. He was studying a genetics specialization. I looked into it. It is a biology science.
Ah, very good.
Makes a mark, as if to say, yes, I've said that now. I found where he was staying. He shares a dormitory with some other youths around his age. Two others. And what else? That was it. I did not take the liberty of interrogating any of these other youths, as you did not give me leave to do so. But what I could glean from the records office and posing as an official, he kind of gestures to himself without doing so, as if to say, well, I clearly look like an official. I discovered that he was military brat, you know, that is why he was over here.
I see.
And he seems to have done well in his classes. I asked whether he was off and off campus and running truants from lessons and so on, but it would appear that his attendance has up till recently been fairly solid.
Perhaps his roommates might know something. I guess next time you go around looking for people to invite to our little club, to our little parties, you might take a stroll to his dormitory area, and if you spot either of his two roommates, inviting them might be might be something worth doing.
Well, these two roommates, Muta. I could. If you would take my advice, Muta. Or at least listen to my opinion.
Well, spell it out.
I did not see the group that you described who were graffitiing the Italo and generally making fools of themselves. But I got the impression that these two youths were quite close to him. They seemed very... Well, they were in bed all morning. I do not think that is particularly unusual for students, mind you. And when I observed them once they were awake come the afternoon, they did not attend lessons. In fact, they seemed quite keen on looking over their shoulders when they were in the cafeteria, their big refectory there. I was sat off to one side myself observing their movements, and they looked quite paranoid indeed. I think it would be more trouble to get them out of the dorm than it would to go in there.
Very good. This is very good. You've done well. If there's nothing really beyond this, I will have to wait on Werner to alleviate the information he has gathered from the church, but you've done well. You've done very well. And I go to him and I give him like a little pat on the chest, and I'll say to him, close to his face, you've made mommy really proud.
He cracks a small sort of proud smile. Muta, that means the world to me, as you know.
I know.
Werner, I did cross paths with him just a couple of hours ago. He had been to the church and found nothing of interest, and so he was returning this early part of this evening to see whether there was anything different once night fell.
Oh, so you've met up with Werner already?
Not through coordination, I regret to say. I've been here for some time awaiting your awakening, and he just stopped by to pick up some things.
Very well. Well then, do you have places to be, people to meet?
Only at your say-so, Muta, although I have been awake all day, and so with your permission, I would appreciate an entire night to sleep.
Well, go gather your strength, then.
May I sleep here, Muta?
Oh, well, yes, you may. And I'll give him a smile, very warm smile.
That was the reward he was looking for.
While waiting for Werner to appear, I'll go and get dressed in my wardrobe. I'll play some music in this on the stereo in the meanwhile, and like describing the apartment last time, like something something kind of like from American Psycho or something like that, this high-class, nice-looking, a little modern apartment there. I would imagine the wardrobe would be expansive also, for my character. It's like an entire room of its own type of thing. So I'll like play music on the stereo, and I'll be there spending some time, getting dressed and kind of getting into it all with all the expensive articles of clothing that I've collected through the years. Most of them bought for me by my by my deceased former lover, but still in use. I'll go through them and try some of them on in front of a mirror and all that, and I'll be almost like a montage scene you could make out of it.
All the different outfits.
Yeah. Some 80s music in the background.
80s German music, of course. So there's a heavy beat as you twirl around in front of the different mirrors, trying to find the appropriate outfit for this evening. After all, you're meeting another member of your clan, if all goes to plan. Not to mention Carl again, and although he is a little on the naive side, he is still of the clan of the Rose, and so appearances must be kept too.
Yeah, of course.
Eventually, you settle. Is there a particular item of clothing that you wish to settle on?
Well, something that, you know, something not too glamorous, but something that fitting to my the kind of gimmick I have going on, you know. Glamorous, but not too glamorous.
Okay. The on the other side of West Berlin, practically in the shadow of the wall, we have the bedsit in which Karl Schweitz makes his unfortunate haven. And he is woken. Fortunately, he can tell from the fact that he does not go straight back to sleep again that the sun must have set. But he is woken by a on the door.
Carl sort of muttering under his breath and gathering some clothes to himself. Do I have a peephole, or is it?
No. There's another banging on the door just as you're an inch away from it.
God damn it. Okay. Well, Carl will shuffle over there, scratching behind his ears, and sort of like partially open the door and peer out.
There's a squat woman just outside the door, looking up at you.
Is it my landlord?
Yeah, it's your landlady. I've been knocking all day, and I guess, and all night yesterday, and I guess that I just guess. You must work all hours, but funnily enough, you do not pay me my rent. You've now been here a month. I gave you 2 weeks gratis, and you give me nothing yet. Don't make me call the bailiffs to kick you out.
Carl sort of like rubs his eyes, tries to recollect, does he actually have any money? Like, has he been paid yet? You can't quite remember. I'm pretty sure you can afford this place.
You are a night chef in a diner, so I imagine, yes, it's probably just never really come up that you should... In fact, you may not have even been staying here until recently. You may have been staying with your sire. You just have this place on the side, which is probably why your landlady thinks that you just must be working all hours and avoiding...
Of course, direct debit is not happening, so...
I'm not leaving here until I get my money. This is a high-quality flat in a high-quality part of town.
Carl sort of just nods. He's tired. He's hacked off. He's not happy. And he kind of like goes to see where his money is, if he has it.
You have a small, like a biscuit barrel in which you keep your cash.
He tries to remember the terms of his contract and then sort of recollected it. We were counting out the Deutschmarks.
The landlady has followed you in. She's quieter than she appears.
Nah,
this place is a dump. You know, when I started letting this place out to you, it looked a lot better than this. Look at that marble. Have you been hanging your washing inside here? There's a perfectly good line out there connecting to the building next door.
Carol's still looking like a very young guy, kind of looks at her and sort of like he's still kind of like blinking and shakes his head. She's asking too many questions. He's got too much going on to deal with this minutiae. He eventually kind of turns around and looks at her with the money in his hand, hands it to her, and says, "Maybe I'm just too young for this. But here's your money anyway."
She counts through. Yeah, this is the money. Just don't make this place a den of iniquity, Mr. Schweitz. I can hear things. I only live upstairs, you know. When I hear noises from down here, they ain't savory.
Well, maybe I'll cook something for you, and that will be savory at some point.
She looked over at your stove with its... it's probably, in fact, the only immaculate part of the bed.
Indeed.
If you're going to cook something, you'll come up to mine and do it. But Mr. Mita will want has a very refined palate.
No, oh, I'm sure it does. Carol nods his head. He's used to this kind of patter from the customers at the diner. He's probably a better chef than any of them have any right to experience in their lifetime, and yet this is the thanks he gets. He just sort of like tries to shorten this conversation as much as possible and then very, very delicately shoo her out of the room.
She doesn't stop looking around over her shoulder trying to spot what's going on, because yeah, she has heard odd noises on the few nights that you have, or days and nights that you've been here, but eventually you get her out the door and close it behind her. You have no phone line in to your flat, by the way. You standing have an exposed phone line, but no phone.
Standing with his back to the door, having just closed it, Carol takes a deep breath. And then sort of stumbles back, and as if by habit, goes and starts to open the fridge and figure out what to have for breakfast, and then sort of stops himself and sort of shakes his head and closes the fridge again. And he goes to the cooking area, makes sure it's clean and tidy, a good habit to stay into for a chef. And then goes and he's probably going to go to work, I guess. So he'll go and get his gear ready, unless I don't have to work tonight.
It was a Friday night before. You can set your hours. Do you work on Saturday evenings?
So I'm working tonight. well, he'll probably spend the early part of the evening cooking, so you'll be in there. Not too many folk, I imagine, know where he works. But yeah, that's where he'll he'll get ready to go there, and that's where he will head to try to be as punctual as possible. In fact, early, I would think, because he wants the kitchen is the only place he really feels at peace.
With your arriving early, your manager is pleased to see you, as pleased as one can be working on a Saturday night in a diner in a city where most of the people staying up this late are probably out to party, and so they're not exactly giving the quality of the food much inspection. This isn't some swanky restaurant. This is a, fast food. This is an O'Tolly's, practically. Hell, yeah, you're a all-night chef at an O'Tolly's restaurant. Well done. Stick some beans in those burgers.
That's it. But I tell you what, it's gourmet. let's see how Carol does tonight.
Let's see how many people die of food poisoning.
With his mighty 8 days of cooking brilliance. Look at that man. Just look at him with his his critical success, producing Michelin star food at Michelin tire prices. He's absolutely, he kills it with 5 successes. So everyone lives, no one complains.
Yeah, you're you are completely in control of the kitchen. The students that are working there part-time are in awe as you dart between the batter, the fryer, the griddle, and those little cups that you stuff your fries into. You're doing it all. It's like you're an octopus, and you're manhandling that kitchen like it's an extension of your own body. The manager is over on the counter. There's another montage sequence. This is very 80s. As you,
my montage music is the music from the training montage from Rocky IV. So, as he rips the chips from the fryer. At the end of it, I'm standing on top of the diner going, Drago!
Starzy policeman, I will crush you. We're on the wrong side of Berlin.
Indeed.
The manager is there, leaning on the counter. Mein Gott.
It's John Von Wayne. What's he doing here?
My God.
Truly, this man is the chef of God.
No, John. It needs more ore. Oh, surely this man is the king of burgers. And the manager says, kid, because for some reason I came all the way over from the Midwest to open this burger joint and it's really not working out. Kid, you cooked up a storm tonight. You can have the rest of the night off. Go do something fun. You've earned your pay. Gosh darn it.
Carl accepts this. He's delighted. He accepts it with a deep bow. He loves his cooking to be praised. He thinks of his sire and the first time she asked him to eat one of his own concoctions, and the description of it reduced her face into a red, tear-stained mask of crimson delight.
Lovely.
She, of course, then invited Carol to lick the vitae from her face, which she duly did. The finest tasting thing he's ever laid tongue on, I guess you would say. And it's far better than hummus and falafel, I've heard. And he's delighted with the praise. And he's going to spend some of his spare time. Carl has a side project. He's going to go back to his kitchen, but stopping on the way at his local supermarket, picking up a very random collection of ingredients, piecing through his mind, yes, the flavour of cumin, perhaps. And he's trying to recreate the taste of his sire's vitae. He wants to be able to make it himself, because if he can do that, of course, he can break this fatal addiction that he has. Then he can make the drug on his own. He doesn't have to get it like a junkie from this elderly, fat, pompous dealer that sometimes he hates her, but he can't get away from the intrinsically linked bond between hate and love that exists when he thinks of her, and he thinks of her often. So as he gathers up possibly the wildest and weirdest collection of vegetables, spices, and herbs, along with probably something like reasonably meaty, some kind of steak probably, which would be bleeding, through a wrapped up paper bag, getting a strange look from the cashier, who I imagine is thinking, what on earth are you going to make with all of that?
This late at night as well. We were just closing.
Yeah, he would just smile politely.
In the shop.
You just smile politely and thank them for. Thanks very much for letting me in, and his own inevitable shy way, gather his groceries and rush home as quickly as his legs can carry him to get started.
In that case, what upon your arrival, I'd like you to do another cookery roll to see what occurs.
I did not do my passive celerity bonus for dexterity last time. So I have actually 10 dice. 10 dice of death. Of course, when you make your character a dice stack chef of doom, you can't really do much else. here he goes. And that kills that.
Friend to the Naga Raja.
yeah. Special accounts, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 with the specialty successes. So another critical success. I don't imagine he'll succeed in recreating the taste of his sire's vitae. He'll always be a step behind that. So.
You think you've come as close as you ever have yet? You barely touch the steak. It's blue. You show it the heat. But the spices that are more massaged into the meat than actually sprinkled on, you don't bother with vegetable accompaniment. It is literally a slab of meat that you are spicing as much as you're able. It lacks something of the metallic edge that you recall. There was something more sharp about it, but you just can't pinpoint what it was. But it's that vital ingredient that stops it from being a perfect duplication. It's at that point, of course, that the meal starts to come back up. And now we'll go back to Anna.
Yes.
It's been a few hours during that time. Carl has, of course, been into work and come out of work, been sent home already. And Werner has now arrived back.
If it's been that long, if it's not like I woke up later than Carl or something like that, if I've had a couple of hours at the apartment to myself before Werner would have arrived, there's something I would have liked to have made a call.
Okay, who would you like to call?
I would like to call Helga.
Oh. You have a number that occasionally reaches Helga. It's not a direct line to her, though. You know it goes through to servitors within her particular domain, of which she is known to have a few.
Okay, but even if it's just a secretary or anything like that, you know, it's I'm simply calling to ask Carl's contact information. Okay. I forgot to ask that myself.
Okay. In that case, you do get through to a secretary or her personal assistant, who at first is very cagey. What did you say your name was again?
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Anna Varnhagen. I am a very close associate of Helga Rothbauer, and I simply was calling to ask one of her other associates' contact information, particularly a phone number from which to reach this particular individual, as I don't happen to have that number myself.
Which club do you associate with Ms. Rothbauer? She is a member of many of our country clubs. Now, you're not automatically going to know the answer to this. So I give you the choice. You can either use your status to perhaps know of one of her surreptitious names for the Camarilla or Clan Toreador, or you can try subterfuge and charisma to lie your way through.
Well, since this is kind of a situation where I don't feel like I would need to lie because I don't have any malicious intent in this or anything, I'm not trying to trick anyone. It's like a straightforward thing. Like I think with the status of my character, I would know it. So am I going
to
roll?
Okay, I'll give you an extra 2 dice to this roll, so you'll get 4 dice to the roll.
I forgot to take my goddamn dash. My fucking eye.
Son of a bitch.
My little dice baggy.
Like a filthy junkie.
Smells of hummus and, well, falafels.
Ha ha!
So, what role am I exactly making?
They're that famous pair of investigators.
So, what role am I making?
So you're just trying to, you'll be rolling four dice, difficulty of six.
Four dice, okay. Oh, shit. That's 1, 1, 7, 5. So, one bunch.
Nasty. In that case, you're going to be the secretary. There's... I would just like your full name. Repeat it for me now, please.
Well, since my character doesn't know she botched, I'm just going to... yes, my name is Anna Varnhagen.
And I would like your telephone number, please.
It's blah, blah, blah. 1, 2, 3, Polizei. Whatever.
Einstein, yes. I will pass your details on to Ms. Rothbauer, and if she wishes to call you back, she will. At which point the secretary hangs up.
I'll just kind of roll my eyes. I was, and I'm hoping that Carl will at some point get into contact with me, because he doesn't know my where I keep my haven. I don't even know where he keeps his haven. Actually, it never came up.
And you've already
been to your haven, have I not?
Hmm?
Have I not been in his haven?
Yeah.
So I know where it is.
You hear the key in the door, Anna.
Well, I turn around and go to the door to meet who I'm expecting to be Werner at this point.
Werner is at the door. Bruno is just behind him. They both nod.
Evening, boys.
Mutter.
So, come on in.
Bruno walks in and takes a seat. Werner remains standing.
So, Werner, what have you to tell me?
Well, it is quite an interesting one, my dear Mutter. He always has a tendency to refer to you in a slightly... you're my child, yet you're my mother, kind of way, because of his age, his apparent age. You see, little one, I went to the church as you directed, and went there during the day, and attended a sermon. The church is some fringe evangelical group, I think. The church at one point looks to have been Catholic. I do not know what events transpired to make it change hands, but it now appears to be some neo-evangelical group. I attended one of their sermons. It was dreadful. Just by appearing during the day, I was given one of their cards. I believe it also functions as some kind of alcoholic recovery group, because they stuck around afterwards. I did not wish to make my cover too elaborate, so I departed around that time. There is a minister there, a man, he does not go by title, like Reverend or Father, but his name is Fuchs.
How do you spell that?
Fuchs. Quite an orator. But words that were partly perished from the Bible and others made up. It was like watching a salesman make some kind of pitch, except I wasn't really sure what he was selling. I returned in the evening in case there was anything different, because they had a board up that listed events all day under various titles. Groups that would attend this church that went by names, almost like political parties or philosophy groups or poetry clubs, things with titles that were not easy to penetrate. And I returned in the evening, and there was another religious service going on after the sun had set. Now, the one thing I found particularly strange that I observed in both services was everyone that attended, of which there were only around 20 people, they practically fought each other to get to the front of the seminary. They all wished to be pretty much at the toes of this Fuchs, or away from the back of the church. I did not ask why that was, but judging from their bulletins, they are running another service at midnight tonight, so it would appear that as well as running their sermons, they also stay open for the purposes of the homeless. This church does not close its doors. It would appear that the homeless stay there overnight.
Interesting. What would you say, Werner, that the sermons were focusing on, especially during the day and then after the sun had gone down?
There was a very strong political edge to it, little one. They were very anti-communist, it would appear. Anti-radicalism of any kind, making their faith into a political standpoint, that the only faith one should have is not in the Reds and not in the capitalists of the West, but in God, and specifically in this Fuchs character. That his way was the only way. He then went on to read some poetry, something 19th century. I did not recognize it, but I'm not an expert. He did not attribute it to anyone, but he said that it was from the 19th century. And everyone seemed perfectly rapt. I could not personally see the attraction.
Interesting.
Of the congregation, also of interest, was it was a wide variety of people. There were I would say 10 were of middle age or older, but there was probably around 5 elderly, another 5 surprisingly young for such a strange service. You know, up to around 20 years old, but ranging from 8 or 9 to 19. I could not see they were accompanied by responsible adults.
All right. Well, I must say, Werner, you've done very well. You've managed to make me very happy.
Well, that always pleases me, Muta. You know, I only exist to make you happy.
Oh, I know, Werner. I know. And I walk close to him, smile, and give him a little peck on the side of his mouth.
And, gives
and I kind of rub his chest and his shoulders, like, you know, if he's wearing a jacket or something of the sort, just kind of cleaning it up and having this smile of, you know, being very proud of him type of thing.
He can't resist the urge to give you a kiss back on your cheek.
Well, I'll smile at him, and then I'll say, it appears I'll need to be going to meet my good friend Friedrich. No, sorry, not Dieter, for some preparations for a party.
Would you like for me to drive you or for Bruno?
Well,
Bruno looks at you almost like a puppy.
Well, I figured you've been up working all day, so you deserve a good night's sleep. I think I'll have Bruno here drive me.
Very well. I will not argue with you, Muta. I will return to my flat upstairs. But if you need for me, you know, all you have to do is knock, no matter the hour.
I know, of course.
There's a ringing on your telephone.
I'll go on answer it. Hello?
Anna.
Do I recognize it as Helga?
Yeah. I am so sorry about the treatment you received from my assistant. I promise you that she... well, but how did you not know the name of our little club?
It must have crossed my mind a little bit, but just couldn't... didn't come up for some reason.
Well, between you and I, if you ever need to call me again, and if you're ever asked which of our country clubs you belong to, just say that you belong to the Ivory Roses. And, well, she'll know. She'll know.
Nice. I recall now hearing this at one point or another, having forgotten it somehow. I do not know how. But what I was actually calling you for was that even though I spent the remainder of last night with your lovely Carl Schweitz...
And how is Carl? He was such an embarrassment last night.
Oh, he behaved very nicely after that.
Well, I should think that he did, given how much he embarrassed me in front of our peers. You know, this was his attempt, this was his prestation. He was supposed to be shown off at this event, and all he did was act like a completely out-of-control lunatic. And, you know, it didn't just reflect badly on him, it reflected very badly on me. It made me look like a sire that had no control over her child. I had half a mind to deal with him there and then, Prince's decree or not, but I suppose that would not be particularly politic.
Oh, you're just being too harsh. Perhaps it's
I've had child at a point before. You've had no child of your own. You did the right thing, just making retainers out of, making, you know, blood fiends, but I went the stupid route of bestowing some of my power on a mortal, making him like me, and now look, I'm stuck with him.
Oh well, I'm sure he's eager to prove himself to you and to our illustrious prince, of course, and I'm here to provide a helping hand in that, of course, because I'm going to need his help as well, especially looking at last night's events. I didn't notice anyone else running out the door, especially anyone outside of our family.
True. So you wanted what regarding Carl?
Oh, just his contact information. I have no idea how to get in contact with him. Last night we went our separate ways, and I only remembered afterwards. Never did I ask for his phone number or anything.
Late mistake. Well, as far as I know, Carl has no telephone number. He certainly hasn't given one to me. And I would have been given one if he had one. But I can give you his address. It's a dreadful little place, but until he brings himself up in station, he's not permitted to stay with me anymore.
Well, that might be a good thing in the end.
She gives you an address very near the wall, and then laughs. Just make sure that you don't advertise your presence. They say Siegel has an army of Nosferatu watching that area.
I think I will send one of my boys to give him a lift to see me. I don't think I will be venturing to those parts of the town.
Yes, do that. Is that all?
Yes, that's all. Pleasure talking to you, but I happen to be extremely busy, so I will have to leave you with my best wishes, and have a pleasant night.
Yes, and you too, Anna. I apologize if I have been curt at all. I'm barely recovered from the trauma of yesterday.
Understandable.
She hangs.
Okay. After that, I'll since Bruno is still there, I'll go to him and I'll say, well, now, it appears there's something I would need you to do for me.
Of course, Bruno. He gets his feet.
I'm going to need you to drive me to Deatus' place. I'm sure you know where that is. And once you drop me off, I'm going to need you to go to this address. I mentioned the address that Helga gave me, and go see if Carl happens to be around. If he is
the young one from last night.
Yes, full name is Carl Schweitz, if you need to ask him from somebody.
He will recognize me, I'm sure.
Yes, ask him to come with you and bring him to Deatus' place. But if he refuses to come with you, just make sure he has my contact information so he can contact me when it suits him then, I guess. But try to be persuasive.
Of course, Muta. You know that I am very persuasive.
I know. Steiner.
Yes, sir. that is now his name.
Carl is now hiding all the soap in his apartment.
Bruno Steiner now.
Okay. Well, in that case, I'll just go and pick up my purse, and I'll just look at him and say, "Shall we?"
You are looking ravishing tonight, Muta. Why? Allow me to take you to our car. He puts his arm out for you to link with his, for you to link up with, and you go to the lift. As you descend, it stops the floor down. A familiar face gets in, the man who always seems to be going out around the same time as you, your nameless neighbour, who looks at the two of you. Nice night for it.
And good evening to you, too.
You descend to the ground, to the underground car park, and walk your separate ways, he to his car, you to yours. Friedrich has dealt with the smashed up Mercedes, Muta.
Ah, very good. In that case, let's take that car. I love that car.
No. I mean, he has... there wasn't really much to do with it, unfortunately.
I see.
But it will not be traced back to the events.
No, it's just going to be a pretty penny to get me something new. Oh well, let's use the substitute car then.
Bruno takes you to the BMW and opens the door for you. Your resources aren't that high. You're not going to be having expensive sports cars, I imagine. And you get in one side, he gets in the other, and you drive off towards the chateau. Now, I can... It's entirely up to you. This can be entirely your game plan, Eunice. If you want, you can pick up Carl first and both head over to Dieter's, or if you want him to arrive later, you can have it that way. Obviously, if you pick up Carl first, there's more likelihood for the two of you interacting.
Yeah, that's true. So I guess I would go and pick him up first, with me still on board the car. While we're going with the car, I look around the interior with just this, I've managed to handle the fact that I'm having to ride in this BMW for just the duration of getting my beloved Mercedes fixed up. But now that it's more of a permanent thing, at least until I would get a new car, it's something that's coming on as a strain for me. And to get my mind off of this, I turn to Bruno to say, could you please turn on the radio?
Of course, Mutter. He puts on the news network first.
Oh, please, put something that has synthesizers on.
Of course, Mutter, there are plenty of those. He switches the channel, and Rammstein comes on the radio.
Yes, comes on the radio. You lose. Continue.
In 1989?
I wonder, 89, was it around then? Oh, well, anyway.
Yes, I hope I'm not insulting Rammstein fans.
Insulting Kraftwerk fans, too.
Oh, well, but anyway, it's... yeah, I'm as long as it's...
The band was formed in 1994.
It's definitely yes that comes on there.
So perhaps this is some early demo stuff or something, some basement recording thing.
Yeah, it's Orgasm Death Gimmicks is the band that's on the radio.
It Feels Good to Me by Bill Bruford.
Okay, but anyway...
The music, there's an awful lot of shouting and...
Oh, well... As long as it's something more modern, I wouldn't want to listen to anything classical at this point.
Mm.
As I'm trying to relax myself, my nerves a little bit, I don't want them to be so relaxed that I'm catatonic.
Well, this would keep, I think, anybody awake. They should have this on the Checkpoint Charlie, I think. There's a lot of bow, down, 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 blah, blah, blah. And you arrive in the
I'm just saying he looks like Scott Steiner.
He's flexing at you in the face.
Okay, anyway. We're driving.
Welcome to my simpy motor. You'll get no simpy from me at all.
All the way there.
All
he cares about is free.
That's Scheiser's quadrant. That's the best thing for an apartment block.
Well, Carl Schweitz lives in Scheiser's. Yes.
Welcome to Das Scheiser's quadrant.
Vampire mysterious business.
Okay, alright. The Firmerstrasse. And there you arrive. Would you like me to knock on the door? You can stay here listening to the music, Muta.
Fine. Go on without me first.
He leaves the engine running as he gets out of the car, and you hear a banging on the door again, Carl.
Arlen looks a bit impatient now. He's been up the bloody landlord again. He's, of course, not a Scottish person. He makes his way to the door and again peers out a crack.
You recognise the hulking figure of Bruno Steiner.
Yes, the chainmail gave you away. He sort of recognizing me, pulls the door open wider and sort of stands in front of him. He looks puzzled to see him here. He wasn't expecting a visitor.
I'm here on behalf.
Hand him a protein shake.
What?
Mein Gott, Herr Steiner. Yes.
Mein Führer, Steiner.
Frankenstein, as you always
say. Yes, Frankenstein, a bandit fan!
Frankenstein, right out of nowhere. He,
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's too much for me. Anyway, so Mr. Steiner.
He corrects himself. Frau Van Hagen would see you.
Okay. Carl sort of looks behind him, trusting he's not. Has he tidied up his workstation yet from the food he just made?
Yeah.
Okay, he sort of. Remembering the previous time he met her when apparently his clothes were so crap that he couldn't be seen in them, he sort of like leans in and whispers, motioning to his current outfit, is this okay?
No.
Oh. What,
you want to go to meet another member of your family? I recommend dressing somewhere between the smart and very smart range. You don't think he's joking?
Carl sort of nods his head. Would you like to have a seat?
No.
Carl sort of looks left and right. Okay. And he shuts the door and goes to get changed. He finds his smartest, sharpest suit, which hasn't been completely eaten by moths. I imagine he probably has one, living at Helga's. She probably dressed him up quite a lot, lavished certain gifts on him at certain times. So he puts on what he considers to be his best suit, and shoes, and sort of tries to make himself as presentable as possible. Then sort of opens the door, and with the Toreador blood kicking in, he doesn't quite give Mr. Steiner a twirl with the fear of being Frankensteiner through the floor. Instead, he just motions at himself again and says, "Better."
Yeah. I will not have to belly-to-back suplex you into the road.
Oh my God! Schweitzer is broken in half. Yeah. Okay. So he'll go with Bruno, and Jim Ross, who for some reason has made his presence felt, locking the door behind him, and he'll head out to the vehicle.
Not in 1989. You're more looking at Ventura and McMahon on the announce table.
What a maneuver!
Yeah. He takes you to the BMW and opens the door for you to enter.
Vince McMahon, the man who you would want most to become the commentator of your sex life, really, let's be honest. So, yes, Carl, not Vince, gets into the car. He'll sit. I don't know, is it like one back seat or is it like kind of two seats facing each other limo style, or is it?
No, this isn't a top of the range Beamer, this is just an estate.
Das Scheisenmotor. He gets in it and sort of props himself up next to Anna and smiles.
Is Anna in the front, I believe?
No, I would have been in the back.
The rear quarters. He gets in there and smiles.
Too bad, Anna. It looks like he's going to an awards ceremony.
Well, as he comes in, I'll smile at him and say, "Hello, Carl."
Carl smiles, looking quite bashful, but he's coming to trust and get used to Anna a bit. And he says, "I made an effort."
You're certainly looking nice.
Oh, thank you. You're looking your usual radiant self, is his best attempt at reciprocation of that compliment.
Oh, stop. Have you actually ever... I dare to imagine you've never met Mr. Dieter Jürgens.
He pauses. This is a name he's heard. Not in the kindest of terms. Helga is not pleased with Dieter. She was never particularly elaborate on exactly why she's not pleased with Dieter, but when she did mention him, and it was reasonably often, it was normally followed by names similar to the apartment block he lives in. She wasn't incredibly complimentary about him, and he's not especially looking forward to meeting him, and you can tell that just by his immediate sort of reaction.
Yes, well, I expected as much since you've mostly been in Helga's shadow at this till this point, but I'm sure that you've at least heard his name, as he is one could call him your brother or a half brother or something of the sort, as he's one of Helga's children. But yes, I'm sure since I'm most likely you've never been introduced to one another.
No. Do you think you'd be pleased to see me?
Oh, I don't think there's any... I don't think there's anything... any ill will towards you. I mean, you haven't done anything. It's... and I'm not even sure why Helga and Dieter are not in speaking terms.
I'm not even sure she remembers now, but Mother Helga did tell me to avoid the man.
Oh, okay.
I will go if it's to help the clan.
Oh, well, it's to help the entire cause of keeping our family tight. Like I spoke to you last night about it, even if Helga is not in good spirits with Dieter, it's still important to keep Dieter's relationship with us in good terms. There's no need to take on the baggage of your sire, you know. So, and especially since your sire is a bit... distraught about last night's occurrences, and since through this endeavor that we find each other in at the moment, we can certainly improve your standing in the in this family. So something like building bridges with people like Dieter is something one should work on. So, I'm not sure if I even mentioned it to you last night that Dieter is planning a get-together amongst our clan, and he invited me and told me to bring someone with me. I did not mention that I would be wanting to bring you, because I hadn't mentioned it to you yet. But after we've met up with Dieter, you can then... tell me whether or not you'd be interested in attending a party of his tomorrow evening.
Well, I don't suppose I should get dressed up for nothing.
Yes, well, I should hope so.
As you've been discussing, Bruno has been driving you out of Berlin. Dieter's haven is just on the outskirts. Of course, Berlin itself is in the Soviet side of Germany. It is effectively in the east. But the outskirts of West Berlin still class effectively as West Berlin kindred territory. It all gets a bit funny. You can tell the difference as you start to leave the urban area, as the appearances of austerity become more recognizable, except for when you start approaching the chateau regions. They don't really go by any other name, simply because this vastly countrified area, largely due to its complete bombardment during the Second World War, was flattened and has been, what would the word be, gentrified, made more rural, and various chateaus of an historic bent have been built in their place by the richest of the rich, by the richest members of the Eastern regime, which should be non sequitur, given that communists aren't necessarily supposed to get rich, but the oligarchs, the industry leaders, and of course, as you know, Dieter Jürgens, one of the chateaus belongs to him, and it's where he hosts almost all of his parties. He very rarely enters Berlin proper to host an Elysium, and of course, the times that he does, he ensures that he coordinates with Helga so that they're not both there at the same time. And as you drive up the gravelled driveway, there's no gate to his chateau, past the rather ornate gardens and to the door with the pillars outside in the overlooking canopy, you can see lights on inside the building on the ground floor. This building, it would probably... would comfortably house around 10 people, you think.
Okay. Before we get out of the car, something that I would have mentioned to Carl would be that, see, this gathering might be extremely important to our little investigation, since all of our clan will be gathered, or at least the majority. If Rosa Rothschild would also attend, that would be a very good opportunity for us to bring up the issues we've been having with and the questions we've been brainstorming about Party Boy, since she, of course, would not attend our Elysium's gatherings. That's only for West Berliners, of course. So this would be a very good chance for us to get to exchange a few words with her. I mean, tomorrow's party would be a very good chance for us to exchange words and probably notes with her.
Yeah, Carol just takes it in. It doesn't really see the need to say anything. It has nothing to say about.
She's an oddball, but I'm sure you'll manage with her just fine.
Is there anything in particular we should be trying to get out of her?
Well, since we've both been having the theories in our minds about the possibility of Party Boy being someone who would work for the East's benefit, or for a paycheck, or for some sort of ideology that he gets from the East, there are certain questions that ought to be aired to her. Since she is a harpy, she might know something that we'd very much like to hear.
Carol sits and he seems to go into a sort of, not trance, but a sort of introspective daze, thinking about what he might say to this person if he's to encounter her.
Also, Matt, there's was Ursula is also Helga's child. Ursula is not Dieter's child.
No, quite correct.
But didn't they hang out like? I for some reason I got the idea into my mind that Ursula might automatically be here tonight if she would happen to be.
She's associated equally with her sire and her brother, and Helga doesn't appear to pull her in either direction, mostly because Ursula doesn't really offer much to the clan as far as Helga's concerned. She's that nice as an attraction, like a freak show.
Yeah.
At an Elysium, but she's not the kind of gift that keeps on giving, not as far as Helga's concerned.
Oh, okay. Yeah, for some reason I got that kind of mix. For some reason I wasn't sure if she was Dieter's child, but yeah.
Dieter does have a child, but that's Paula Trautschult.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Well, just need to get that out of the way. But,
Bruno has been at the door of the chateau whilst you've been having your discussion in the back of the car. And it's been opened by a rather ostentatiously dressed, complete with frill cuffs and cravat, butler, who has spoken to him in hushed tones, nodded, and directed Bruno to where he can park the car. Bruno comes back towards the car and says he has said that the Herr Jürgens is awaiting you, and I will be parking the car at the rear of the chateau.
Very well, Bruno. We will go on our own from here, then. I'll give him a smile and then go to step out of the car.
Yeah, Carol will also get out and take a look around the grounds and then up to the chateau itself.
I'll hold my hand out for him to give me his arm to.
I'm turning into my old character. Carol takes your hand on his arm. He seems quite used to this being an escort, so to speak. Oh my! And he sort of strides. Asher seems to sort of it's a role he's familiar with. It seems to empower him a little bit. And then he begins walking with you up towards the chateau.
The butler sees you in, takes your coats, hangs them up, closing the door, and doesn't address you in the way of conversation, knowing exactly who you are. Takes you through and past the number of rooms into the grand hall that you know exists, and I believe you have been here before, where he announces you to the mostly dead air. Frau Anna von Hagen and guest, Herr Jürgens. The butler nods and departs. Within the grand hall, the grand table, which is usually ever present there, and where the vampires who come to dine in this area will often sit around drinking the wine-tainted blood that Dieter is known to specialize in. The table is missing. In its place is a great art installation. Well, you could call it an art installation. It's got something of a savage quality to it, shall we say.
Self-control now.
There's a great mound of skulls that are bound together with hair through the eye sockets. through loops and loops and loops, and you just mentally you try and count the skulls quickly, and there's more than you don't know how many are in the interior, but there's at least 25 to either side. Dieter is stood looking at the two of you approvingly. There's another figure who is kind of crouching around it and examining the arcs, trying to get the best visual of it, who you recognize, Anna, as Gunther Lechtenbrink, who was at the event last night as well, although didn't do much.
All right. I have him for some reason written down here, but anyway, once I say this and we arrive, I'll immediately put on a smile and I'll walk towards Dieter with Carl, and I'm guiding him through the hall, and I'll go to Dieter and I'll say, Dieter, darling, wonderful to see you.
My love.
I'll go to give him a peck on his cheek.
It has been too long. What, 2 months?
Yes, I surely missed you last night, but such is the way. I did not inform you beforehand, but this here is my friend, a new member of our illustrious family, Mr. Carl.
Cuts off, looking up at Carl and saying, "That's Helga's other child, Dieter," and then he carries on looking at the installation. Dieter's warm smile cracks, and then it's back again.
Carl's sort of not warm smile is uncertainty cracks and then comes back again.
Schmeitz, another child of our devoted mother. I would shake you by the hand. And then he laughs. What an interesting gift you bring me, Anna.
It is no gift.
When he says, "I would shake you by the hand," Carol's hand goes out, and then when he laughs derisively at him, it sort of slowly goes back down again.
It is not intended as a gift, dear Dieter. It's, I simply realized that you missed the opportunity to meet him officially, as everyone else did. And since there has been all sorts of things going on that I'm sure you've already heard at least one side of, there is ample reason for us to keep our family's foundation strong, and that is why we must not continue to balk on each other based on sins of our fathers, should we not?
Sins indeed. Carl, you must accept my sincere apologies. He takes a few steps towards you and puts his hand out this time.
Carl, half expecting an electric buzzer to be hidden on his hand. after that welcome now, sort of very gingerly, trying to recover some semblance of a smile to his face, eventually takes the hand and shakes.
Don't worry, I have been in your position, being introduced to another child of Helga, long since departed now. I'm the eldest of our little family, of our group of siblings. So I have been here where you are now, and I know this is not always comfortable, but, you know, we make the best of what we've got. And I'm sure you are making the best of it, and I'm sure Mother is treating you with devoted passion.
Out of character. She's a cunt! In character. Carol just sort of nods and says, yeah, she does her best.
Well, you know, she has an awful lot of pressing on her. What with a role in the city.
Yes, she's always been very impressed by my cooking. He smiles, hopefully.
I've heard tell. Gunther here was telling me about last night and how you actually went about eating food. That's quite a trick you've got there, Schweitz. You know, my talent is in the wine. I am a vintner. I believe in the power of the wine as an aphrodisiac, as an intoxicant, as something that opens up horizons. I think that, food aside, the wine is the real mind opener, opens windows, and, well, shall we say that is why our sire embraced me, wondering if I could lend that same talent to the Vitae, and I would hazard that I have succeeded to some degree. My little soirees are popular. I intoxicate the kine and on various vintages, certain strengths, and you drink from them, you can taste the wine in the Vitae. It is a simple trick, but only I know the exact measurements that make it so that, well, you have to add certain things to the wine. That is the greatest tragedy. I do not wish to bore you, but certain preservatives, certain antioxidants. You see, when it gets into the bloodstream, it can, well, lose all of its flavor. And if you put too much into it, it can make it impure. It's taken me many years to reach a stage nearing perfection, and I dare say I will never reach it. But now you know me, and I've already heard about you. And Anna, I do not know. I'm guessing Gunther has been introduced to you before. Gunther, stop looking at your art. Lechtenbrink stands abruptly, strides over, thrusts his hand out to Carl.
Carl now feeling a bit more emboldened. He was actually very interested in what Dieter was saying. Might have interjected with remarks like, like a Kobe steak. You know, like preparing the cow if you want to be slaughtered, much in the same way as he seems to do with the kind vessels that he prepares for his wines. But when he's approached by Gunther, he, feeling more emboldened, more confident, will take and offer a more firm, more self-assured shake than he did previously. Going along with the style in which he's introduced himself, he simply says, Schweitz, and gives a half nod.
Yes, your trick last night was very entertaining. I hope that you will find my trick similarly so. He gestures at the art installation behind him. These things take months, sometimes years to prepare, but never, when they are presented in the right lighting with the correct music accompanying them, or sometimes just in a void all on their own, they can drive a member of our clan to heights of emotion that you would put your little food tasting gimmick to shame, dare I say. And Frau Varnhagen, always a pleasure.
Likewise. But I must say, Dieter, there has been the tail part, but no show yet. Would we not be subject to taste your vintages?
Dieter laughs again. And you know that I do not like to present my vintages or my wine-soaked vessels before the party. This is the night before. You cannot expect me to ruin my surprise, even if Gunther is happy to ruin his. Tell me, I do not, and Gunther calls me a hack for saying so, when I see these skulls stacked up and bound with hair, I do not see art, I see morbidity.
Yes, I was actually paying some attention to the grotesquery of this concoction here. I am not sure if it's meant to shock or is it just somewhat juvenile approach to the grotesque.
Hexenbrink is nodding.
Just to editorialise, Carl's probably walked forward and had a wee look at this as well after that barb that was thrown his way about his performance as he sits there looking at it, not becoming entranced, thinking to himself of the state that Heinrich worked himself up into with merely one bite of a pastry in his display. He feels almost like turning around and backhandedly slapping this upstart as his Toreador blood rages within him.
Lechtenbrink stares avidly at Anna. Yes, 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 you are feeling all of these things. You're feeling juvenile humor, you're feeling horror, grotesqueness. What is the overriding emotion that you feel when you look at this piece? Does it just horrify you? Does it just make you feel a little sick? Does it repulse you? Does it bore you? Does it make you feel anything?
As someone who has been... someone who is very appreciative of the arts and has been for a long time, this does not, in all honesty, make me feel those things. It makes me feel like the creator of this piece might wish for me to feel those things. But
as you say, this Carlos
going about it through an approach that I would like to see be put some more work and finesse into. There's little subtlety here, and I must confess that ever having turned on the music television channel and seeing some of the long-haired bands that these days play on, I've seen enough skulls to last a lifetime.
So you think this is old hat, then, Frau von Hagen? Do you think that this is something that you would find on the MTV or one of those? Well, I can tell you, and I think you will be very impressed, that I liberated these skulls and this hair from, and Dieter cuts him off. Says, do not ruin your peace before the party, Gunther. If everyone comes in here like this questioning it, then you build anticipation. You don't just tell them when they walk in through the door, otherwise they'll just shrug and say, well, that's that then. If your aim is to horrify or astound, you do it at the crucial moment. You leave them guessing and thinking. Well, not all kindred have been kindred for as long. I have been a kindred for a good few decades, Dieter. Well, I have been under the knight now for near a century, and I am bored of juvenile displays, people that display their talents with enthusiasm have clearly never been disappointed before by the talents of others. I have been disappointed many times. I know to hold my talents in cautious regard. There will always be someone who is not impressed, so my aim is to build up anticipation. What do you think, Carl? It sounds like you put your party piece on immediately. You played all your cards up front. What can you do to entertain the kindred of West Berlin now?
Carl sort of, because he's like sort of stepped forward to look. He kind of looks over his shoulder back at him, and says, "I truly am not an entertainer, but," when he looks around, "are any of the wines available?
What to buy?"
No, I simply, even though I've never met you before, your skill as a sommelier is legendary, and in my profession, this is something that would go hand in hand. I would very much like to test some of your work.
Well, perhaps you could wait until tomorrow night, unless you are looking to drink a glass of wine.
Carol nods his head.
Ah. Usually that's reserved for the kind.
Yeah. See, you will get a private show now, won't you?
Well, perhaps later. I invited you here, of course. Gunther, excuse us. Lechtenbrink leaves, and Dieter closes the door behind him. So will both of you be attending tomorrow night, first of all?
I certainly am, and I wish to bring Carl with me.
He is more than welcome.
Oh, yeah, I wouldn't miss it for the world.
You must know, Carl, that your sire may admonish you for spending time with a reprobate like me.
Well, I haven't been admonished by her sire. I fear she may not. When the mood takes her, I've great regard for my actions, as I'm sure you have learned over the years.
Well, if I can assure you of anything, it's this. You can disappoint her constantly. She will never raise a finger to destroy you. She loves her child, or as much as she hates them.
Carol actually considers this, thinking it a strange reflection of his own feelings towards her.
Anna, tell me what occurred last night. I'm here. I heard bits and pieces from Gunther, but given that he identifies himself as an anarch, everything's a little coloured in the positive light. That the prince was humiliated, that some mortals breached the masquerade, that your sire was outed.
Yes, well, All of what you have heard are very much on the note. It's Carl here was displaying his unique skills and enchanting the entire crowd with his performance. As I'm sure you will get a chance at one point or another to see his. His unique and interesting abilities as a member of our clan with our sensibilities. His performance was interrupted by a sudden flash of photography, someone barging in through the front door and photographing my dear sire whilst yelling out his name as a movie star from the 20s, as he put it, and therefore feeling that they most likely that they have some kind of a proof or to which to use, perhaps to extort or blackmail or just to get one's get one's jollies out of doing this sort of reprehensible stuff that someone that I'm sure you've heard a lot about, this infamous party boy.
Yes, never been to one of my parties.
Yes, I've never seen his face myself, nor have had any confirmation about his affiliations with any certain clan. There's been many rumors. Rumors being nothing more than rumors of him being a member of our clan. Enough so that when he indeed barged in and ran off, our illustrious prince talked to me as if I was responsible for his actions based on our affiliations through our blood and our clan.
He looks at you stony-faced. and cuts you off. Are you his sire, Anna?
I am not, but but I guess in your experience, this is how a sire would treat one's child, perhaps? Embarrassment and enragement?
Well, I wonder what the prince knows to place this blame so firmly on our clan's shoulders. Yeah. It seems strange that he would buy into the populist rumor rather than actually seeking out further information, but it just speaks to the gangrel mindset, the Occam's razor of clans. Every route must be the simplest, every answer must be the simplest. If this party boy likes parties, he must be a toreador. I'm sure it sees him through in many occasions, and I certainly have no bad blood with the prince personally, but sometimes things are a little more complex than I'm sure he would like to know.
And I'm sure that as far as he's gone in his own life, it's most likely he's not speaking his mind out freely. So he might not even consider him to be a toreador for as a fact, but something that illustrated him clearly not being a member of our clan was the fact of how he made his entrance. He made his entrance by dominating the doormen, making them sit silently on the ground while he spray-painted a smiley with fangs on their chests and then burst in through the door with the flash photography. That automatically points to anything but a toreador, unless, of course, since I did not see his face, and nor have I ever seen Party Boy's face myself, I couldn't have been exactly sure if this was simply another kindred lackey of his, but to be honest, I wouldn't expect him to have that sort of an influence where he would have kindred lackeys. But then again, our investigation is in its earliest stages at this point. I was actually hoping to see if you've managed to get our beloved Rosa Rothschild into your party tomorrow.
Funny you should ask. As I say, Lechtenbrink is an anarch, and so... I do not know that Rosa has sympathies with Gunther, and I certainly hope not. Gunther's political aspirations do not gel with those of our clan, if I may say so, but certainly the Anarch movement does not do us any favors. But yes, I extended an invitation to Rosa.
If you mentioned this artwork to her, she might enjoy the show as
well, she RSVP'd. She intends to come with a guest. Gunther informed me that during Carl's presentation, he was warned off of speaking to any East Berlin kindred of our clan. I was not informed of this edict after the invitations had gone out, and I'm not going to insult Rosa Rothschild now by saying, oh, by the way, you cannot come to my party with your child. So, yes, Rosa intends to come. It will be fine to receive her. I have also invited Marcia, so that could be an interesting little firework display. But if our plan is good for anything, it's putting on a good show. Tell me, Carl, he looks over his shoulder. Herr Schweitz. What do you know of our little family dynamic here in Berlin?
As far as I'm aware, we are to... well, find this provocateur, this party boy, and... or whoever the guilty party may be.
Yes, but what do you know of our little family conflicts? You know that our mutual sire will not speak with me. You know that Anna's sire is the venerable Heinrich George. it would appear, and I would guess by your youth, that your knowledge is fairly lacking.
I suppose nowhere near your experience. I'm aware there is one other sibling, and he sort of racks his brain trying to think of the name.
Ursula?
Yes.
Yes, pretty little girl, when she's not got her mask on, perhaps not so pretty. Shall we say that if you are looking to advance in the political domain within this city, your best bet is to get close to Marsha Blumenfeld. She is a fine, fine specimen.
Primogen,
quite. I have had many a daytime fantasy about her, I can tell you. Once we were fortunate enough to share blood, around 80 years ago. Mm. But she is all too sedate these nights.
When he says that he shared her blood, Carol suddenly sort of blurts out, "How did it taste?"
So obsessed with the flavor of things, Spice. I can remember the taste as if it were just last night that I drank it. A mixture of sweet and salt. Like boiled sweet of my youth. Like a bullseye with an aniseed center, but coated in a salted glaze. It burst in your mouth like something you had never tasted before.
Carl is practically in his mouth. He's leaning in so close to hang on this. Everybody can begin to see why Helga probably selected him to be her child, and probably much the reason she chose himself. He nods sort of frantically. His eyes begin to probably look a bit bloodshot, and as his obsession begins to kick in, yes. Was there a metallic taste? Maybe an iron or a copper oxide, or
sometimes the wine, if you buy those awful bottles with the metal caps, can acquire a metallic taste. There was something to that. But there was more aniseed than anything else. Do you know Pernod Ricard, Ouzo, the aniseed liqueurs?
Yes.
I occasionally dabble outside of my speciality, shall we say, in getting the kind dosed on spirits. It never works quite as well. It is not like massaging the alcohol into the flesh, but there was something more to that about Masha. Something stronger. But then she is of a reasonable age.
Yes. So there's something missing. There's a vital element missing, even from the finest drink and the finest food. It can't quite get into the the blood of a mere mortal being. Charles seems to be quite impassioned and
surrounded. Oh, I let out a little chuckle while he's foaming at the mouth at this. I'll let out a little chuckle. Well, you certainly sound like brothers.
Yes, don't
you're
we?
You're on the same tree, aren't you?
It would certainly seem so. That's right, calm yourself for now. Enjoy tomorrow night and the party that we will have. I am sure that it will be a rhapsody on your tongue. Anna. Yes. Search then. You are searching for this party boy.
Yes. And it is really not a wonder that this incident has brought about lots of certain type of, let's say, paranoia mixed with the conspiratorial theorist mindset since this whole separation of our glorious city is up and running all this time with Breidenstein and Ehrmann. It's impossible for one not to go to all the possible lengths to this party boy thing. We've already wondered how deep does this go. Is he working for someone? If he is working for someone, who could it be? Who could benefit from this? Who might simply want to do this to provoke? Who might in any way do this as a political maneuver to try and push others into actions that are pre-planned to certain extents? Or is Party Boy simply doing this out of his own need for attention, or childish need for some kind of attention that would come from this? Or is Party Boy simply a persona that's been created by the hysteria? It's at this point there is so little tangible about who he is, where he is, and what he's up to, that we're looking for all kinds of clues at this point.
The only kindred.
I must mention that last night Carl outdid himself after, in the midst of his performance, as this all happened, he was the one who ran out the door after these people, and we wound up courting one of them of this group of three, one who didn't happen to be Party Boy himself, of course, but we got him in bits and pieces due to an ill-fated car collision, but still, we already know that these are youngsters. They are students. They are people who hold very strong and fringe-leaning political ideologies mixed with religion and such. There's a lot at play here that I'm excited to get to the bottom of, to be honest.
Yes, it sounds like quite the mystery.
You can see surely after all this why I would be interested in getting to exchange a few words tomorrow evening with our beloved Rosa, would you not?
Well, not that I am particularly au fait with Prince Breidenstein's machinations, but it does not strike me as sounding like Breidenstein to send this party boy out to disrupt and embarrass our prince. But he may be doing some kind of double bluff. He could be more intelligent and subtle than we give him credit. He has been around for quite a few hundred years. Rosa, I'm sure, will be quite interested in speaking to you. She's always happy to speak to the West, and Kindred, and I'm one of the few that maintains regular contact. My supposition, purely without evidence, it sounds more like an anarch leaning. And I do, Gunther's art aside, which has caused quite a stir in our clan, as you know, I don't have much time for the anarchs. But then, why would they do things to breach the masquerade? It does not serve them any more than it serves us.
That is exactly my point that I made about Breidenstein and this incident.
Well, we do know, of course, this Cold War that the Kain are so obsessed with, it's winding down. It cannot last forever. And when that happens, well, Berlin's going to become a very interesting place. If it comes to war, well, the actions of this party boy aren't going to mean much. If it comes to votes, which would be something of a revolution, well, if Party Boy has sufficiently humiliated Airman, our Gangrel Prince, not many people are going to vote for him. But does that mean they would vote for Breidenstein instead? He's hardly an attractive candidate.
If both Ehrman and Breidenstein are both filling up this theory of this being a purposeful provocation by the other party, I'm hoping this doesn't wind up to the point where a stunt by this party boy is taken as an outright attack on the other side, which would lead to declaration of war between us.
Very interesting. I can't claim to know much about this party boy, aside from knowing that the only kindred that I know of who's ever claimed to have seen Party Boy is our sheriff, Oscar von Humboldt, who was humiliated in person and has since dedicated his existence to tracking him down, and clearly without success, which doesn't speak much for our sheriff. Of course, here's a suggestion completely out of nowhere, but as we're discussing that kind of thing, do we even know that this party boy is kindred? Well, Doomkopf, of course. Someone dominated the prince's doorman, but maybe it is a title that gets passed around. Between anarchs, between East Berlin kindred, between West Berlin kindred, there are plenty here.
Party boy character is a rather... it's not a very old idea. It's something that has sprung up only recently. So unless it's... I don't know. At this point, your guess is as good as mine, really.
Well, I would be interested in finding out the results, of course.
Of course.
But this is the 10-minute warning, because unfortunately John has to leave early tonight. There is something else that I wish to speak to both of you about. This is merely preparations in the event that something occurs with the wall and the Cold War coming to an end. And the reason I invited you here a night earlier, Anna, it was not to do with Party Boy or anything like that. It is because I see you as a similar kindred as myself. We, shall we say, travel in the same circles. We're not seen as elders of our clan. We're not seen as striplings, fledglings, either. Yet, were war to come to our streets, it's the kindred like us that need to make a choice as to how we act. You know, if Ehrman were to go to war with Breidenstein or the other way around, the Primogen would send kindred like us to fight, and I've done enough fighting. I wonder, hypothetically, you understand, because we do not know that this is going to occur, what would your take be on exercising the right to remove the clan Toreador from the conflict entirely, and to essentially hold out our hand to those who wish to join us in our neutrality, but turn our back on those who insist on taking part?
Well, since we're completely just shooting the breeze here, as it were, then nothing serious with these hypotheticals, I should think that if we were to do that, we would be condemning Ernst Ehrman to death very much. It would be very much us already declaring Breidenstein the winner if all the Toreador were to declare neutrality.
And Breidenstein is not going to suddenly forgive the Toreador for turning our backs on him for the last 50 years or so.
Of course not. Mm. But you know me, east or west, family is the only thing that really matters to me in the end. It's the most important.
And Carl, you're blood bound up the ass to our sire. I remember that feeling.
Carl can taste entrapment in there. and sort of ponders his answer very carefully. He says, yes, but not so much that I can't see what's happening in front of me.
Seeing is one thing, acting is another, but like I said, I'm merely speaking hypothetically. It will be interesting to see what goes down, but whatever happens, I intend to survive it. My friends in the East seem quite concerned that there will be inter-clan bloodshed, and that old grievances will attempt to be settled. You know, Marcia and her sire, of course, Olaf. Who, of course, I suppose by relation, is your great-grandsire, Anna.
You will be correct in that regard.
Well, he is firmly entrenched with the East. Marcia is firmly entrenched with the West. I think it would be very interesting. It would be interesting to see if this party boy does play a role in all of it. And what you can glean from him once you can track him down. And I'm sure you will, you know. The reason the sheriff has never managed is because he's just not of our clan. He doesn't share our particular enthusiasm for the hunt.
Well, he does share our taste for attention and the spotlight, surely. But and perhaps if one is to consider graffiti a form of art, one could go the distance.
Well, it isn't. But that's subjective, of course. What do you think, Carl? Is graffiti an art form? Or is it just vandalism?
I would say it is the passing whim of someone without the patience to consider truly creating something worthwhile.
I look at Carl with a wide smile, and I kind of put my hand on his back and kind of, I look pleased at him.
Carl, you watch that hand of hers. She'll make you one of her child before long. Now, I said that I was going to get you a bottle of wine, Carl. I alluded to it, and so I shall. You've been entertaining. So do feel free to wait here. He leaves the room. Closes the door behind him, leaving you in the grand hall with the ornament, the installation, and each other.
I don't think I need to really say it out loud, but do not take everything you hear here to heart. We're just talking. Right, sweetheart?
Yes, yes. Forgive me, my sire's warnings leave me concerned that there's more to even the most subtle of conversations than meets the eye.
Yes. We must tell them what they want to hear at the moment.
It did make me think, though, about our friend Party Boy.
What do you have in mind?
His shtick is to breach the traditions. It's not Breedenstein's MO. It's not his. Obviously, yes, you know, sending an agent provocateur over here, but it damages to damage the masquerade. My sire told me very, very, very carefully, it's not just a betrayal of one's prince or one's court. It is a betrayal of every kindred on earth. And that's why it's our most treasured tradition. That's what I've been told. That's what she told me every day. And could this not be a conspiracy? Could this be simply the elaborate bullshittery of one crazed man?
It very well could be. I was I found it rather entertaining that Dieter would mention his possible Adark tie-ins, but I suppose some people, whenever they see someone who's disruptive, automatically see them as an anarchist. But if they would be working to any goal, breaking the traditions would not help them.
Yes, but if the talk is all of one prince or the other will fall, one prince or the other will rule, with the anarch talk, a third option perhaps for some.
But still, even the anarchs hold the traditions close.
Dieter re-enters. I'm sorry for keeping you. He gently passes a bottle to Carl.
Yeah, if Carl still has his jacket, he'll sort of wrap the bottle in it so that he's not transferring heat through his hand. Of course, but he has practiced as such, and that is simply a habit for him to do that.
That is of 1913, made in Bavaria. You do not often hear of grown in Bavaria. My mistake. Grown in Bavaria, bottled in Berlin, and it's a fine red, I think you'll find. The German wines are not often seen in terribly high regard, but I guarantee you will be pleased with that one, if you can indeed taste it. If you can hold yourself, of course, bring it back with you. That one travels well. You will not find it too badly damaged by the journey, or of course keep it here. But I have more than one bottle, so if you just wish to taste once, I will forgive you. I meant to say, latest news from East Berlin, I don't know whether you heard. Breidenstein received a Justicar of the Camarilla.
Oh, you mean the one who got his limbs chopped off?
Ah, you've already heard.
Mm. Word travels fast in Berlin.
Yes, a wall does not separate our ability to hear, it would seem. Member of Clan Tremere, I understand.
Oh, so that would provide an extra sting, perhaps.
Well, I gather that is probably why Breidenstein took his ire out. After all, the Tremere are no friends of East Berlin. But I fear we must conclude at this point with you departing the chateau. Yeah, and heading on your way. Just so I'm aware, are you now heading to the university or the church?
I was planning on going through our plan with Carl in the car before we would decide on either location.
In that case, you can discuss in the Facebook chat at your liberty and where you will reprise. We may be able to reprise before Saturday evening next week. We'll have to see what
I can make it next Saturday anyway, so...
Well, in that case, we will try and aim for a different evening.
Damn you! Real life.
I'm going into a party, boy!
My God!
Alright, I'm going to stop the broadcast. Thank you very much for watching, people who have continued to watch.